Today, we're going to talk about how the airbrush actually works. And then at the end of the video, we're going to use that information to figure out a couple of tips to make your day-to-day experience of the airbrush that little bit easier. I'm Warwick from Harder and Steenbeck, and this video is part of our series of Need to Know Basics. So, if we look at the airbrush, what we can see is where the air comes in, at the bottom here, through the air valve. The air comes in, goes to the front of the airbrush, and at the front of the airbrush, it rushes out of the air cap over the paint nozzle at very, very high speed. This very high speed, as it goes over the paint nozzle mouth, creates an area of extremely low pressure right at the mouth of the fluid nozzle. And it's this low pressure that causes the paint to be drawn out of the front of the airbrush. The paint is loaded into the paint cup here and enables it to be drawn through the fluid nozzle. Once that paint has been drawn out of the fluid nozzle and it's out of the airbrush, it then goes into this extremely high-speed airstream, and the energy of that is what breaks that paint apart into this incredibly fine mist that is what we associate with airbrushed color. As we come a little bit further back along the airbrush, we'll see the trigger over here. The trigger's got two functions. The most important function is that it controls directly the movement of the needle. The needle essentially creates a valve with the paint nozzle. When it's fully forward, that paint nozzle is closed. Paint cannot flow out the front of the airbrush. As the needle progressively moves back, it progressively opens that valve up, the fluid nozzle, and allows more and more paint to flow the further it comes back. And as it goes forward, it progressively closes that flow down. The trigger and all this equipment in the back here is really there to just transfer the motion of your finger as perfectly and faithfully as possible to the needle. At Harder and Steenbeck, we do a lot of work on trying to make sure that that connection is as direct as possible, because this is really what will go a long way to making your painting experience feel as intuitive as possible. So as we pull this trigger back, that rearward motion corresponds to the needle moving back and forth, in and out of the front, out of the fluid nozzle, and allowing more and less paint to flow. The other function that the trigger fulfills is it also controls the air valve. As you push it down, it enables air to flow, and as you let it up, it shuts the air off. Many years ago, we did some development work at Harder and Steenbeck where we talked to our painter community, and we understood that people wanted to, the more advanced painters, wanted to potentially be able to have some control over their airstream power at the trigger. In order to deliver that, we created an air valve stroke, the up-down part of the trigger, that was a little bit longer than the average. And this gave more control to the user in terms of being able to control the air pressure at the trigger. That's not how you need to paint. That's really an advanced level. But the point is, the option is there with a Harder and Steenbeck airbrush if you choose to explore that. Going a little bit further back, and this is the tip that I referred to at the start of the video. All of this equipment in the back of the airbrush, it's all part of the mechanical workings of the airbrush. It is not part of the painting part. The important thing to realize here is this part of the airbrush, from the back of the cup and forward, that's what we call the wet part of the airbrush, where the paint is. Everything rearward of that is the dry part of the airbrush, where the paint is not. Now, as long as you stick to the basic rules and guidances that we give you in other videos on our channel, you should never get paint in this rearward part of the airbrush. And the thing that's significant about that is if you don't get paint there, you don't need to clean it after every session. So many people we talk to in the community, they talk about stripping their airbrush fully after every session. It's really just not necessary. It does take quite a bit of time, and I don't believe it really adds anything to how well your airbrush functions. So the little tip that I'm going to give you at the end of the video here is just understand that it is really not necessary to fully strip your airbrush at the end of every session. Focus on cleaning the wet part from the cup and forwards. The back part, if it's still feeling nice and smooth and everything feels good, that's fine. The analogy I'd use is when you use a paintbrush, which many of you do, your cleaning focus at the end of the session is 100% about the bristles. You're not going to spend 20 minutes cleaning your handle. Why? Because you just don't need to. And it's the same with the airbrush. Okay, take that time, paint for longer, have more fun. Don't worry about cleaning that back end, because if you're painting it the right way, you don't need to clean it. I hope that was helpful, and I look forward to seeing you on more videos. Thank you.